Rajdeep, where was the clock again? Ah, there's a clock. Okay, good. Beautiful. Okay, so what I'll be telling you, actually, it was Vijay's lecture was is a great introduction in some sense that we're both talking about topological systems, and he started it. I guess Janendra also talked about, I would say, what was the original or the mother of all topological systems, which was the quantum Hall system, and then Vijay tried to give a general perspective, a very mathematical perspective to what a topological system in condensed matter is. And what I'm going to be doing is actually I'm going to try to get through the next couple of lectures. I'm going to try to give you a very empirical or experimentalist perspective at some level of what a condensed matter, of what a topological systems are and what kinds can they be. So actually, this talk is going to be slightly. This lecture is going to be a slightly different format. They're going to be actually strongly based on an online course that I co-taught with Anton Akhmarov on. It's on EDX. You can probably find it. If you want to sign up, it's again just topology and condensed matter. But for those of you who don't want to go to the trouble of signing up on EDX, the material that I'm showing here, you can also find on this just on this link. If you have your laptop, you can definitely feel free to sign into topoconmag.org. Okay. All the material I'm talking about is all there. And what I'm gonna do, ideally, why I recommend going through this on your spare time, the structure of this, let me just quickly show you what it's like. So, in this one, at least, there's basically, there's a syllabus. I'm not going to go through the entire material, but it starts systematically, starting from toy models and zero dimensions, and then sort of builds up towards 3D topological insulators, and then you go down to wild systems, and then it ends sort of at the fraction, sort of making some comments about fractional quantum Hall, but not really very well. And each section it starts with a video, which obviously which introduces the spirit of the subject and gives the concept, the basic motivations, and then the concepts are introduced through text and equations and simulations. So I'm obviously going to skip the video, but that's the basic structure. So any questions? And you should feel free to interrupt me at any time. So any questions? Oh yeah, bigger font. Thanks. Good? Okay. All right. So now what I'm going to start to do is start talking about what am I going to call a topological system, and at some level it's going to be somewhat different from what Vijay called a topological system today morning, but they ultimately they sort of merge. The basic mathematical notion of topology, or the basic notion of that topology introduces, is continuity. Right, that's where like set topology starts. It's a way to define what it means to be continuous. And in that spirit, what we're going to be asking is what kind of systems. And and for this discussion, it's going to be all non-interacting fermion systems. And what non-interacting fermion systems are basically what Vijay defined today morning, Hamiltonians that can be written that are quadratic in fermion operators. So basically, they can be represented as single particle matrices. So what we're going to ask is, in general, when can these Hamiltonians be turned into one into the other continuously? And in some sense. Now I'm going to make that a little more precise. So let's start by thinking about the simplest thing, a zero-dimensional system, which is like this dot. It's just a puddle. And in this puddle, you can have a bunch of electrons. They can be in states like n, and they have some energies en. Right? That's what you have. And what I'm going to ask is, I'm going to change this Hamiltonian. So this is h. These are n's are the eigenstates. En's are the eigenvalues. And I want to ask, what happens when I try to change the Hamiltonian continuous? Okay. So in general, what happens, if we just look at the spectrum, so what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to start, so I have a Hamiltonian parameterized by a parameter alpha, which I'm trying to change from H prime, from H, which is an initial Hamiltonian at alpha equals 0, to some final Hamiltonian H prime, right? As alpha goes from 0 to 1. And what will happen in general is that these eigenvalues will change in some way. What I want to preserve, or what I call continuous, H of alpha is continuous. But what I want is that it remain gapped. While I do this, during change. Okay? So the name of the game for our, what we're gonna define as two Hamiltonians are topologically the same is going to be that if I can change Hamiltonian H to H prime with a transformation like this, which is continuous, while remaining gapped during the entire process, right? And just to be specific, for this case, we're gonna say gapped means that there is no E equals zero eigenvalue. This is a little bit arbitrary, no equals zero eigenvalue. So around E equals zero, there are no stakes. Right? So if I attach a lead from the side, like I'm showing here, like in some experiment I could do here, I try to inject electrons from a lead from the side at zero energy, I should not be able to do this. That's what I'm gonna take to be the definition of gap. And now the question to you guys is, So zero I'm defining to be the chemical potential. Yes, thanks. So here, does H and H prime look like they have are topologically equivalent? No, good, right? Because they're clearly crossing zero. Okay. So the next question is, now what about this one? Does this look, okay, yeah, I hear no's and yes's, and I think this is good. So it's no in a sense because, yeah, this is clearly touching zero. But on the other hand, I could have moved this touching slightly below, and then it would not be touching, right? So then these two in a sense actually they are topologically equivalent. So what I'm trying to emphasize is I don't have to stick to this linear relation. I can invent my function for the Hamiltonian in between. I have the freedom to move the eigenvalues in between a little bit down or up. So based on this, it's actually quite easy to guess what the so-called topological invariant is. Okay, this. So the topological invariant is going to be the object that doesn't change between two Hamiltonians that are topologically related. So does someone want to guess what it could be based on this picture that I had above here? So what property of the eigenvalue spectrum here could be the topological invariant, which means that if it is the same, then you can change from H to H prime only if this object is this object the same. Sorry? Beautiful. Yes, the number of eigenvalues below zero. So in this case, can you remind me how far am I supposed to be able to go? This? I can go up to here? Okay. Sorry. Good. So in this case, So this is the case that I'm going to call, there are no symmetries yet, and dimension is zero. And in this case, the topological invariant is just equal to number of E less than zero eigenvalues. All right? And so this is an integer. So far, so good? Okay. I can scroll. Oh, I can infer it from this table. Was it on? Sorry. Turn it on. No, it was on, actually. Okay, it's okay. I can get a little exercise. Okay, so that's the basic concept of the topological invariant, and it's over there. Yeah. So, okay. Now here's a spectrum where I'm going from H to H prime, and now this topological invariant Q is the number of eigenvalues below zero, and what you see is that every time it changes, and this is again a trivial statement, the only way this happens is by a state crossing energy zero, just because it's a number of negative energy eigenvalues. Okay? So every time you change Q, you get a state at zero or a gap closure, and actually that has a fancy name called the topological phase change. Closing at E equals zero state when Q changes. Yes. Sorry? What do you mean? So if it crosses back again, or so for example, right? It crossed. So your topological invariant went down and then crossed again and went back. So If they cross at places away from zero. In this, with this definition, that doesn't change the topology. So this is a zero, this chemical potential reference is special. Yeah. No, because otherwise your spectrum has crossings all over this place, but the important, so physically, actually, that's a good question, actually. So physically, why do we care about E equals zero? And as Krish said, it's about the chemical potential. And I guess the physical assumption about the chemical potential is that is up to where the electrons are filled. So at some level, these are the active electrons near E equals zero. You usually do not care about what electrons much below the Fermi energy are doing. And actually, there is a more precise statement that can be made about the density matrix. You can actually, yeah, but let's not worry about it. I mean, you can literally get rid of it. Yeah, thanks. Okay. Now, so again, this is something that Vijay was introducing, and he actually started here, was the role of symmetries or conservation laws. Where do symmetries come in? Where do symmetries come in? Okay, so first, the simplest kind of symmetry is like a unitary symmetry, right? Like the one that which is the linear one that Vijay was talking about today morning. And at some level, you can just think of it as ultimately some kind of a conservation law. But this one we're not going to focus on much, because what you know is that if you commute with A. This is the same. U dagger H U is equal to H is the same as saying that H U is equal to U H, which means you can simultaneously diagonalize. You can get simultaneous eigenvalues. And which means that you just focus on each sector. So what do I mean? Let's think of a simple case. U is the sigma z Pauli matrix, right? That's like the spin of the electrons, right? So let's say your Hamiltonian conserves spin of the Hamiltonian, then you can basically think about H up and H down separately. We'll just think about the topology of H up and H down separately, and then that problem we can take over. There's nothing new for that. So we just have to. So we can get rid of all the unitary symmetries like that. Okay. Now, let's think about some more symmetries, some less trivial ones. Yes. So time reversal. If you remember from today morning from Vijay's talk, there was this theorem of Wigner's that all potential symmetries were either linear or antilinear, and the prototypical antilinear symmetry theta is time reversal, which is typically written for fermions as I sigma y times complex conjugation. All right. So now maybe this is a quiz just to see how much about time reversal you remember. So what statement can you make about the eigenvalues of a Hamiltonian which is time reversal for fermions? Sorry? Kramer's degeneracy. Beautiful. Yes. there's a theorem, and it's, and this is actually, I'm glad that you answered it, because I had this, there seems to be, between different communities, even in theoretical physics, there seems to be different levels of affinity for Cramer's theorem. I taught quantum mechanics last fall, and then the part two was taught by a general relativity person, Ted Jacobson. And he, I really had to convince him that Cramer's theorem was like important for anything. He really did not want to teach it. That was totally useless. But the statement here is that all eigenvalues are doubly degenerate. Okay, good. So then the next quiz question would be, if we go back and ask about the topological invariant for a zero-dimensional dot, but now with time reversal symmetry, what do you think happens? How do you think it changes in this case? So the topological invariant is still the number of energies below zero, but something about it is different now. Sorry? Yes. Beautiful. So now it's an even integer, and so the topological invariant is no longer z, but it's 2z. So that's one example of how did that mouse work now or no? Okay, if it didn't, it's fine. Okay. All right. So now I go to another symmetry, which is actually a strange one. It's called sublattice symmetry. And again, for this one, why this one is a special one? It's really the kind of arguments that Vijay was making that I think solidify it. But for now, let's go on physical arguments. That a system like graphene, let's say, I took a graphene quantum dot. So graphene is just this hexagonal. Is it working? Oh, wonderful. Yeah. So graphene is just this hexagonal lattice with nearest neighbor couple. So one of the things that you can say for graphene is that there are two sublattices. They're called A and B. And they're basically, so the lattice is a triangular lattice, but you would let's say this atom, this triangular lattice, but then A sublattice connects to B sublattice, right? So there are two atoms per unit cell in graphene. One of them is the A sublattice, and the other one sublattice. Does that make sense to everyone, or should I draw it? Good. Okay. And then if you look at the Hamiltonian, then it has this weird property that sublattice A is never connected by this Hamiltonian to itself. Only A is connected to B. So the Hamiltonian in the sublattice basis is completely off diagonal. And this is what's called sublattice symmetry. And it's actually related to something called chiral symmetry. And again, the origins of these words are mixed between basically condensed matter and high energy physics, so it can be a little confusing. But if you don't know anything, then it's great. It's not confusing because I can just introduce my own definition. So if you have a Hamiltonian which is completely off diagonal, I can define my sublattice operator as something like this, and the Hamiltonian anti-commutes with it. This is the more general definition of sublattice symmetry, that it anti-commutes with the matrix that squares to one. Well, okay, I guess this can also square to minus one. But is S squared always plus one? Okay. Sorry? Oh, yeah. This would be zero. Thank you. Yes. Okay. So you have something like this. All right. So now the question is, what happens if you have sublattice symmetry? So something, so again, now we have to, there's no Cramer's theorem that is standard part of the quantum mechanics curriculum, so I should just do a little bit of algebra to show you what happens. So if I have an eigenvector, if I start with H, psi equals B psi, so some, let me keep my own notation, so previous notation, so N equals that, then if I apply H on S of N, then this is minus S H on N, which is minus S E N on N, and which is minus right? So which means that eigenvalues come in E and minus E. So now we can come back and ask the same question. What's the topological invariant? And, okay, now you would say that it is equal to some fixed integer n. If the Hamiltonian is 2n by 2n, then this is some fixed integer n. But this n is now fixed. It can't change. So this is basically saying that there's no invariant. This is just zero. So you get it that it's n, right? Because if I have an n by n matrix, I have all my eigenvalues come in en and minus en pairs. So if I have n positive and n negative eigenvalues, right? So the number of eigenvalues below zero, that just cannot change. And so basically, this definition is not a useful definition. And the bottom line is that you can actually argue that everything can be, so here, you can always, between any two, you can always deform, you can always add a small perturbation in the middle, and you can take any Hamiltonian with chiral symmetry in zero dimension, another one in chiral symmetry in zero dimension, and you can turn one. So the invariant is just, oh, it's because, well, right now I'm just doing, it's just a matrix. Everything I'm doing is just a matrix. There's no space. So there's no notion of dimensions yet. I haven't really told you what dimension does. In that picture, I think with my definition, unfortunately, will fail because E equals zero is gapless, and I am restricted so far to gaps. Okay. So now I come to the next symmetry, which is particle hole symmetry. And this, unfortunately, is going to bring us to the part that Vijay, he talked about particle hole symmetry, and the context I'm going to be introducing is the superconductivity, and he sort of skipped over this a little bit. So I'll go through this. So the next symmetry is this last symmetry. It was the last symmetry, one of these transposing symmetries that Vijay talked about, which is sending psi to psi dagger. It's also called charge conjugation. Okay. And at least the context in solid state physics where this arises most is when you have superconductivity. So this is a typical Hamiltonian for a superconductor. It's called the BCS Hamiltonian. So the funny thing is I'm gonna make it sound like it's, I'm gonna try to make it sound as simple, but you should remember that Barden Cooper Schrieffer got a Nobel Prize for figuring this out. So it's not, okay, justify, but that was more for justifying why this is true. But in retrospect, I think it makes sense. So so the first term is the kind of Hamiltonian that Vijay wrote down, right? It's just non-interacting fermions for some, for so C dagger n's create fermions, and I have a matrix. So that's, are there any questions about that? Just to make sure I don't lose anybody. Okay, all right. Now the special thing about a superconductor is that it has a reservoir of Cooper pairs. And these Cooper pairs can jump into the dot and turn into a pair of electrons. So you can get rid of a Cooper pair and make a pair of electrons instead. Or you can take a pair of electrons and get rid of a Cooper pair. Right? Okay. So that's the basic BCS Hamiltonian. Now, okay. Now what I'm going to tell you is what is good, but actually we don't really like having, we really like our usual. Usual non-superconducting fermion language. And the reason is because that allows us to think purely in terms of single particles and just use the Pauli exclusion principle to fill up. So just diagonalize my matrix, a single particle matrix, and fill up, again, fermions up to some chemical potential. We can use that rule. So to do that, I need to make this H that I wrote look like something like this, C dagger, some matrix times C, just like the way that Vijay was doing it. But now this C column that Vijay wrote before that only had C daggers, now unfortunately we'll have to have Cs as well. Right? That's the main difference. And this is called the Nambu spinner. And then you can actually just check, and this is just a little bit of algebra, that this H is literally is now the same as before. So with this Nambu spinner, it's the same thing. So is that, it's just a little bit of algebra to check, and maybe you should just do it as sort of home, back at home, where if you arrange your C's with C's and C daggers and you expand it out, you will get back the H from that I wrote down before, this H there, yeah. If you substitute, if you stick this into here and HBDG into here, then you get back. So the math fact makes sense to everyone? Okay. Yes. No, I think it is a minus here. Okay, I have to check. I don't really, it's possible that there is an error sign error there, but I think it is a little unlikely because this has been through two rounds and of online. So that's a very good point. So for those of you, there are unfortunately several Nambu bases. This is the problem with the life of superconductivity. But let me wait to come back. I'm gonna come back and make that comparison. But in this basis, I think this is the correct one. Yeah. Right? Okay. So good? Okay. So now, so now I have a matrix. So this is good news. I just have a matrix now. I don't have to worry about the second quantized superconductivity and all that mess. I just have I'm back to my usual kind of comfortable territory. But now there is this other anti-unitary operator called, So now what does the particle hole symmetry look like in this language? So let me just, so it looks, my claim is it looks like this, and let me explain why. So particle hole. So what I needed to do was send some CJ dagger to CJ and vice versa, right? But my capital C looks something like CJ, CJ dagger. So, and actually just to make things more easier to track, let me imagine that I not only do I need to send CJ to CJ dagger, but I need to send some any multiple of CJ dagger to this conjugate. Right? So I need something like this. So then this operator, so let me put alpha star alpha. So I need to send this to alpha. I want to send that to alpha CJ dagger, alpha star CJ. Right? So how do I do this? So basically I need to interchange these two, which means it's a tau x. So this is then zero, one, 1, 0 times complex conjugation times alpha star CJ, alpha CJ dagger. Right? And this is tau x. And this operation, let me make this arrow bigger, this is the particle hole operation. So the particle hole operation is tau x times complex conjugation in this basis. So all I have to, so now what does this particle hole operation do to the BDG matrix? Well, it turns out that if it preserves H, but because I have to flip fermion operators now around, but do you remember now this was the normal ordering that Vijay was talking about? When I go through this particle hole operation, I would have turned all the C's on, I would have flipped the orders of the C's and the C daggers. But now I need to flip them back, so I get an original, a minus sign. So the final rule that I get is that this BDG matrix, when I conjugate by the particle hole operator, has to flip sign. And this is the definition. This is basically, once you have derived all the second quantization, once you've derived these rules from the second quantization, then we're back to just having a BDG matrix which satisfies this property. It's an operator that's antilinear and that anticommutes with this operator. Okay? So far, so good? This one, tau x, well, this is just this matrix, right? It's not really a transport operator. I'm reluctant to call it a transpose operator because, it is like a transpose operator in this, but okay. So transpose operator is technically not quite linear. I don't wanna, it's literally this matrix. So it is true, well, okay, at least for 2x2 matrices, what you're saying is correct, that if I apply tau x something, tau x to a 2x2, it'll transpose. But unfortunately, if it's bigger than 2x2, then this is not true. So I just think of it as this matrix. Right? Okay, so now given that I know that this is my particle hole, now my next question is, what is the, I'm gonna play the same game. What do I know about the spectrum based on? So particle hole. Okay. So what happens is, let's say I start with the same equation, and now I apply, and this H is now HBDG. I apply particle hole to N, So I apply H to the particle hole of this. Then this is equal to minus, it's almost the same as this chirality operator here. Except that this is now, P is technically an antilinear operator, but it doesn't matter. And then I just get, this is minus En, P times N. Okay? So, your naive guess, so what would be your naive guess for the part, the topological invariant at this point? It's the same, it should be zero. Unfortunately, that's the trick. That's a trick point, and it isn't. And to see that, all you gotta do is again make two random Bogoliubov degen matrices, and actually here, let me just tell you one quick comment about all these plots here and matrices, they're actually. So if you go into the page, they're actually code. And you can actually like look at the code and play with it and change the matrix and see for yourself. If they're written in Python, it's a very MATLAB-like language. It's not very difficult. And it's very easy for you to play with these things. So I encourage, if you can do that, that's the best. But in any case, now if you just take two random Bogoliubov degen matrices, and so with particle hole symmetry, make a linear combination and plot the spectrum, you see something like this, right? So can you look at this spectrum and look at the one from chiral. Can you sort of, does anyone notice? Exactly. In the chiral case, these are avoided. And in the particle hole case, here, these crossings are actually there. And you can zoom in as much as you want. Actually, it turns out you can try to change the Hamiltonian as you wish, keeping particle hole symmetry, and you cannot get rid of these avoided crossings. Okay? So, and sort of why is this? So there is a physical reason. And a mathematical reason. The physical reason, let me give you first. So the mathematics is not too useful because you can. This is almost a homework exercise. You can check that if you have particle hole symmetry, and if you have a degenerate level let me write down the mathematical statement and then give you. And the topological invariant I'll comment on in a bit. So the math statement is that, so let's say I have some state n and p of n, which are at e equals 0. Okay? So now if I want to turn the crossing, if I want to take h and turn it into h plus delta h, does someone want to mention how would we go about figuring out if you can get rid of the crossing or not? How would we calculate the? Yeah, degenerate perturbation theory, right? So you would calculate the matrix for delta H, which would just be the matrix of N delta H and N the particle hole and something here. And something. Right? And then you would diagonalize. Turns out that based on, sorry? Oh, yeah, P inverse. Oh, but actually, in this case, you can check P squared is equal to 1, so it doesn't matter. That's a good point. Turns out you can show that if you have if delta H satisfies particle hole symmetry, this one is exactly zero. You cannot split the degenerates. All right. But let me give you. But that's just an exercise. I'm not gonna bore you with that piece of math. It's a little more involved than this. So. So to get the physical interpretation, let's go back to second quantized notation. Second quantization. So these n's are kets, and they're eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the Bogle-Lyubov-Degen equation. So what does it mean back in second quantized notation? What it means is that my original second quantized Hamiltonian can be written in this form. Right? These are second quantized. So no, we are sort of back, but this is not. So these DNs, daggers, are. They're the ones that diagonalize the Hamiltonian. So they're like U N M C M dagger plus U tilde N M C M, something like that, where the U's are, the U matrix is the one that diagonalizes the Bogle-Lyubov-Degen Hamiltonian. Right? So we had a Bogle-Lyubov-Degen Hamiltonian. There will be something that diagonalizes, some unitary matrix that diagonalizes it. Or these are the eigenvectors, if you will. And can write H. Right? So, but now what does the particle hole symmetry do? Particle hole symmetry just turns dn dagger to dn. Right? So when n and pn are crossing zero, this is in second quantization, what is happening is actually something quite dumb. Dumb as in like something obvious and not profound anymore. If I have, okay. So when I have a level n and pn, so I'll zoom into one of the crossings. Is it a question? This is the energy spectrum. I zoomed into one of the crossings, and the energies have opposite signs. When this crossing is going to zero, what's really happening is that this quasi-particle energy d dagger n is going through zero, and this is just saying that dn is going through zero with the opposite sign. But dn and dn dagger are not distinct. They're really the same fermionic level. So it can't. So the fact that there are two of them is just an artifact of the Nambu spinner. Like this dashed line shouldn't even be there in a physical sense. So so in some sense it doesn't make any sense that it crosses with itself. This crossing is not physical. Well, okay. Yeah, this crossing is not physical. But what is physical actually? There is a physical component to it. Actually, let me draw it with the opposite slope. It doesn't matter, but it's a little easier to talk about. Let me have a level that goes. Yeah. And okay. So what happened here? So now if I imagine I'm changing, so what happens to the physical system here? So, and this is quite an important and interesting thing about superconducting Hamiltonian. As you're changing this parameter, this level used to be, so remember, everything below zero is occupied. Right? So Now, as you change this parameter, this level is still going to be occupied. It's not going to, well, in the system, this level is occupied because, well, there are certain number of electrons, and it's not going to suddenly change. Unless you have a lead, which is maintaining your chemical potential, and then what happens is that as soon as this level crosses, this particle just hops off from to the lead. Right? So at this point, and again, this is the sense in which is the phase transition, the fermion parity changes. So your topological invariant didn't change, but something called fermion parity did change. This is a very subtle point, so thanks. So first imagine that there is no lead. Okay? Right? So lead is just a piece of aluminum or a piece of metal that you're connected to. It's what sets the chemical potential. And if you're connected to the lead, then you have to be in equilibrium with it. So let's say first you're not connected. And you're changing the parameter. And so your electron is occupied here, and then what'll happen after your parameter crosses this point. This energy is now positive. But if you're not connected to the lead, your number of electrons cannot change. So it's still going to be occupied. Right? Because, the number of electrons cannot change. Right? But now you ask, what happens if you are connected to the lead? Because to define the topological invariant, I said I needed a chemical potential. So I need to be connected to the lead. In that case, what's going to happen is, as soon as this energy crosses zero, you have to lose this electron to the lead to make the chemical potential back to zero. So that means at this point, the number of electrons changed by one. Right? It decreased by one. Okay? But there's a catch. There's this. What I just said was a technically, politically incorrect statement because if I scroll back to my Bogoliubov-Dijon Hamiltonian, something is not a good quantum number. Does someone want to say what is not a good quantum number? Number, right? Number of electrons is not a good quantum number because you can pull two electrons out of vacuum or put two electrons into vacuum. So that's why I said fermion parity, not number. Fermion parity is either number mod 2, minus 1 to the number mod 2, or it's just minus 1 to the number, however you want to call it. So it just counts whether you have an even or odd number of electrons, and that's what changes when a level crosses. Because, I said the electron changes by 1, which means fermion number had to change by 1, that would be a problem because number is not defined, but what you can say is that whether the number was even or odd changed. For sublattice symmetry, see, both of those levels were real. So let me first, So there was no, it did not come from, there was this no separate second. These two levels were two different second quantized levels, and they crossed for real. Right? This was not, it was not a fictitious level, which was the particle hole of the other level. But a more mathematically satisfactory definition, you'd probably be more mathematically satisfied by doing the calculation. Yes. Exactly. No, that's absolutely right. So that's a beautiful point. So you would say that at this point it feels like why did we double the space and then say we have to throw away half the space and therefore it's not physical? Why did we have to go through this? The trouble is that let's say you had another crossing. And now let me draw it this dashed line. Let me make this dashed and this solid, okay? If you threw away all the dashed lines, then you will also throw away the crossings of the dashed lines and the solid lines away from zero. And those crossings are not forbidden. Those are all allowed by particle symmetry. Only the crossing between states, which are their own particle hole, are. So to do the whole formalism, you really need to keep this. This is something like, and I know this is a sort of really, it's okay, it's sort of a, I guess, a sledgehammer kind of analogy, but I like to view this as the condensed matter view of gauge theories. But again, it probably doesn't make a lot of sense to most of you because that's why I call it a sledgehammer. Yes? They are still orthogonal. They are still completely orthogonal. This Nambu spinner. Yeah, that's a good point. This Nambu spinner, it looks like it's a double representation, and so you would have issues with orthogonality, but the way it's constructed is completely orthogonal. So coming back, so there are some states, and this becomes very clear if you, read through Kitaev's treatments of some of the gauge theories. You have to introduce a redundant description oftentimes it's much helpful to introduce a redundant description. And then you get a local, and then you sort of get rid of the rear investigator. So that's kind of the feature. Okay. So, and it's actually this redundancy. So I'm going to talk about Majorana fermions. That will be the next thing I'll talk about. And they seem like, they'll sort of seem like magic, but then it'll turn out that this redundancy is where the entire specialty comes. No, hold on. Thanks for the question. So here the C's are operators right now, the way I've defined them. So then there's no sense in which they can be real. They can't be. But that does lead to, so the Majoranas are going to be these real spinner, real fermion operators in some sense. So we'll come and see. But there what will happen is that you have to take C and C dagger, and you'll have two. You'll have to keep the real and imaginary parts. There'll be two reals. You can't just have one of them. All right? Okay. Yes. Yes. This cannot happen. So S-wave has more symmetry that does not allow this to happen. This is actually good. So here's the simple reason. And I could even give you this as an exercise or a puzzle, but for the sake of time, I'll just give you the answer. The point is S-wave also has time reversal symmetry. So you have Cramers together with particle hole. So the crossings will happen. This line will be doubly degenerate, and that line will be doubly degenerate. And there is nothing that forbids you from removing pairs of crossings. Right? It's only fermion parity. It's only the single crossing that you cannot get rid of, because it changes the fermion parity. Right? And this thing is called. This is a physical effect. It's this fermion parity switch. It's a fermion parity switch. And it's just saying that I can take a superconducting system, and I can sort of tune some parameter, and at some critical value of the parameter, I'll kick a fermion out, and that changes the fermion parity, switches the fermion parity. Okay, so now, that tells me I have to invent a new topological invariant. What's your guess for what object that we have talked about so far? Ignore the board a little bit. That should be the topological invariant. something that changes. Sorry? Fermion parity, exactly. So it should just, so now, my topological invariant, when I have particle hole symmetry, is fermion parity. Okay? And this thing has two values. Right? And therefore, this is Z2. It's a Z2 invariant. Right? It can have two values, and every time out here, every time out here that I cross, I change the topological invariant. All right? Okay. No, because that level, so okay, let's think about the upper level, so right? So here this is unoccupied, but this has to be unoccupied because if D dagger is occupied, then D is unoccupied. Yeah, it's a hole, right? So when it crosses, you magically have the situation where D is now occupied and D dagger is has to become unoccupied. So yeah, so that is it. Right? Okay, so now, there's a technical point, and I don't know that I want to go into this. Okay. Is it good? Okay. So now there's this technical point. So how do I compute this fermion parity? And so it's tricky, but I don't really want to go into very much detail. But the basic idea. Okay, so basically what you want is you want some function of the matrix that counts how many crossings of zero energy eigenvalues you got. So it should flip sign every time one pair of eigenvalues crosses zero. So you want to count parity of crossings. Right? That's you want some function that does that. Turns out that you can do a unitary basis change that takes every particle hole matrix into an antisymmetric. Can just actually explicitly write it out in terms of H and delta, and it's just this thing. Okay. And once you have an antisymmetric matrix, there is a well-known function, and okay, for those of you who are math nerds, you might remember or not, that there's this thing called a Pfaffian. Whenever you have an antisymmetric matrix, you can take a Pfaffian of the matrix. And this Pfaffian naively is just the square root of the determinant. Because, okay, what it is, this Pfaffian actually turns out to be just a product of one half of the eigenvalues. So you have eigenvalues that come in E and minus E pairs, but you only multiply the E's. If you took determinant, you would multiply all the eigenvalues. But for Pfaffian, you just multiply one half of them. And so whenever you get an odd number of crossings, that changes sign. The definition that it's the square root of the determinant is useless because what you care about is the sign of the Pfaffian. And this, well, the square root, you have a sign ambiguity. But there, basically the bottom line is there's a function you can look up and calculate. Okay. So, okay, so that's where, and the Pfaffian rears its head, yeah, so whenever you have this crossing, so if you take your Bogoliubov Dijon Hamiltonian, calculate its Pfaffian, again, this is just some code, the result of some code, every time you get this crossing, this Pfaffian changes sign. And this was not just drawn by hand. This was calculated. It's literally just the Pfaffian. Okay. So I think we are ready to move on to move on beyond dimension zero, so we can move to the next dimension. But before that, any questions about the zero dimensions? No. So just like the determinant, remember? So I can give you, I can write down the Pfaffian for one matrix, but unfortunately beyond that, I think I'm lost. Actually, you know what? Since I have my computer, let me take advantage of it. Okay. So here are some Pfaffians. Oh. So it's just like the determinant. So for the simplest 2x2 matrix, that's the smallest matrix you can take a Pfaffian of because it has to be antisymmetric. The Pfaffian of A is just A. I guess for this, oh, for odd dimensional matrix, for 3 is odd, so yeah. It's always 0 for odd dimensional matrices. Because again, remember, Pfaffian is the product of the eigenvalues, and turns out that for odd dimensional antisymmetric matrices, there's always one eigenvalue. And then for 4x4, that's the next non-trivial Pfaffian. So it's just some function that you can calculate. That's why I didn't want to spend too much time on it. It isn't a whole lot. Okay? Other questions? Yes. Yes. Yes.
But in your case, you only get positive integers because you have only the number of occupied states. So I am a little bit puzzled about it.
I guess I'm taking the liberty of probably subtracting out some constant. Because, it's a question of is it versus, it sounded like it should be positive integers based on my argument and not all integers. But you see, for example, in the chiral symmetry case, I set it to 0. So it's not quite the number of eigenvalues, but let's say the number minus half the size of the matrix or symmetrizing something. So for example, the chiral case, I had n eigenvalues for a 2n by 2n matrix. And I set that to 0. So I'm subtracting out an n. Yeah. Sigma x, then minus I sigma x. And then complex conjugation squared, which is 1.
So the thing is, if you were to do a transformation of your Hamiltonian, the form of that would just change to this.
So now this is a... what transformation? So you have to be careful. So by bottom line is, you can have other matrices there. You have to be careful about what matrices are allowed in front of the complex conjugation. So these are, it's about representing the time reversal in different bases. And, but the key thing is that it has to square to minus one. So I sigma y x, I sigma x times k, that's not the, that's not related to the regular time reversal by integer transformation. Okay. All right, so now let's go to one-dimensional systems, okay? And here, I've got 20 minutes, so I should be able to make some progress. You might think, we had all the key ingredients just from zero-dimensional systems. So we had a topological invariant. We had the symmetry dependence of the topological invariant, so now and it was all super simple. So why go further? So what's going to turn out is at least one more key ingredient of topological systems, which is called the bulk boundary correspondence. This really requires going to at least one higher dimension. So at least we have to go to d equals one before we can say that we are qualitatively are complete. And this is easiest in my view to illustrate with Majoranas. Even though some more, like Viktor Yakovenko or people from the 80s, topologists topological physicists from the 80s would say the Schumacher-Heger model was like a simpler thing. But okay, I'm biased and I think this is better. So anyway, but they're going to be pretty much equivalent. So okay, so let's say, so what are Majorana fermions? And this brings us a little bit to the question that was asked about taking the real parts of C and C dagger. So maybe I should do this on the board because it's kind of important and it's an important cute trick. So Majorana. And I'll put the fermions in quotes. There are some purists who really get annoyed because these are not technically fermions, but it's at some level it's an irrelevant debate. So basically the point is if you start with a fermion, so you have a fermion creation operator, C dagger, right? And you have a operator C, and these satisfy the properties basically CC dagger commutation, anti commutation is 1, and C dagger squared equals C squared equals 1. That's what you have for this test, right? So now what you do is you treat these C and C dagger as complex numbers, and you write C dagger as gamma 1 plus I gamma 2. Divided by 2. So this is literally like taking sort of the real and imaginary parts of C and C dagger. So gamma 1 is C plus gamma 1 is C plus C dagger. Gamma 2 is C dagger minus C divided by I. Okay? So you can do this to your fermion. It's just a transformation. And then you can ask, what are the properties of this gamma 1 and gamma 2? And they're fermion, okay, so firstly, they're Hermitian now. So gamma j equals gamma j dagger. So just like, so we wanted them to be real and imaginary parts, so they're Hermitian, but they're still fermion-like, as in the anti-commutation. Hermitian, fermion-like. And these are what we call Majorana fermions. Okay? So a side note, so Majorana fermions are actually very convenient to understand superconductivity because if you remember from the last slide, we did a basis change to go from particle hole symmetric matrices to these anti-symmetric matrices. Turns out that this same basis change is what takes you from fermions to Majorana fermions. So the BDG matrix, or the Bogoliubov-Dejean matrix, it had this strange form in this fermion language. In Majorana fermion language, it'll just be an anti-symmetric matrix. Any anti-symmetric matrix. Okay. So that's the property. Now what's special about one dimensions and Majorana? So the first the first observation is that any real system in condensed matter is made of electrons. Right? Everything is made from electrons. You can have emergent particles, spinons, anions, whatever you want, but ultimately the microscopic constituent for any condensed matter Hamiltonian starts from electrons. So what this tells you is that any system made from electrons should have an even number of Majorana fermions. You cannot get an odd number of Majorana fermions in your system from any from anything physical. So if you took, let's think about our first one-dimensional system. This is called a Kitaev chain. So you just make a chain of these fermions, but you think of each of these fermions as a pair of Majorana protons. Okay? And let's say you just wrote a non-superconducting Hamiltonian, just a regular Hamiltonian down, then the second quantized Hamiltonian would look something like this. It would be gamma 2n minus 1 times gamma 2n. This is just some algebra. So I start with, so let me write here. I start with, so the simplest non-superconducting Hamiltonian I would write is minus mu sum over n cn dagger cn. And this, if I make this Majorana basis transformation, would look like this. Right? So just some math. And this looks, so this is some kind of like paired system. Right? Yes. Oh, thank you. That's a very good question. So the question is, we know how fermions act on, a Hilbert space. It takes an empty state and turns it into a filled state. And if it's a filled state, you have an exclusion principle. So what happens for Majoranas? So, very good question. So C dagger on number equals 0 is number equals 1. And C on number equals 0 is 0, let's say. Right? That's how it usually. So what happens is basically that gamma 1 on number equals 0 is number equals 1. And gamma 1 on number equals 1 is number equals 0. That's because number is related up to a constant to I gamma 1 gamma 2. So number is C dagger C. And if you plug in those definitions over there, up to a constant and a factor of 2, I guess, it's going to be, I think it's 1 minus I gamma 1 gamma 2 over 2 or something like that. Right? So if you just do a little bit of algebra, you'll see that gamma 1, it's a very funny operator that it flips 0 to 1 and 1 back to 0. Okay? And that's why it's actually called a Majorana fermion. That's going back to the history a little bit. It's a fermion that is its own antiparticle. So if you act it twice, it goes back to itself. Okay. So there are no unpaired. So in this this so-called trivial Hamiltonian has no unpaired Majoranas. It's just paired like this, right? It's completely down. Okay. So now, let's just try and write a Hamiltonian, which is has a different pairing. It's this one. So if you can imagine a fermion hopping, which does this. So instead of gamma 2n minus 1, it looks almost the same. It used to be gamma 2n minus 1, gamma 2n, but now we just shifted it over by 1. But with this shift over by 1, there's this one guy left, one fellow just left sitting there. And this Hamiltonian, if you go, you can then transform back to fermions, and it'll look something like this. It'll look something like this with t equals delta. So you just take this. So you have these Majoranas here, and I just make this substitution again back. And I can write it back in terms of electrons. And it'll be something. And that's the Kitaev chain model. All right? But the important fact, now, so that brings us to the yeah, I have 8 minutes, so I should at least make the main point here, which is we are in one dimension now, and what we have learned is something about topological edge modes. So I told you about bulk, well, it was zero dimensions. The only thing that there was bulk. There was no edge, really, of a zero-dimensional system. But there it used to be, the property was that we had, that there was a topological invariant in the bulk which could not change without moving, without closing a gap. Now we have topological edge modes. And the example of this is this unpaired Majorana. And so the definition here is a state that cannot exist in free space. Or can't, let me make it sound positive, can only exist at a boundary. So these are what are topological edge modes. In the case here in point is an isolated or an odd number of Majorana modes. An odd number, I just told you, every system is made of electrons, an odd number of Majorana modes cannot exist in isolation, but it can exist at the end of something. Right? And this is going to be our other theme. And finally, what we're going to get to is a correspondence between the exist when these edge modes happen and what property of the bulk topological invariant makes it happen. And that's called the bulk edge correspondence. And that's going to be sort of the key feature. Okay. So, all right, so let's get back a little bit. So we just made our CC dagger substitution into the Majoranas modes, and we got back a Hamiltonian now in terms of electrons. This is a Bogoliubov-Dejean Hamiltonian or superconducting Hamiltonian like the one you saw. It's basically electrons, some chemical potential, some hopping bit of the electrons, and then some superconducting pairing. It's nothing unusual. This was the model that Kitaev wrote down. And you can take it into Nambu spinner notation, and it looks like so. That's fine. Okay. So now the next question is, let's say now so I showed you these Majorana modes at a very specific point, right? It was this special Hamiltonian with these pairs in a particular way. You might ask, is this a special point or is this generic in any way whatsoever? Okay. And the answer is, at least from numerics, what it looks like. So let's say I have, this is back to the smaller font. So what is plotted here is a spectrum of some finite length of this Kitaev chain as a function of the chemical potential. What I showed you before, so if you remember, the completely non-topological limit was no superconducting, so no superconducting pairing, just mu. That was sort of this extreme limit. Mu over T goes to infinity limit. What you see in the spectrum is that there's no zero mode. And the other limit was the mu equals zero and T limit. And that, there we argued, just from this Kitaev picture, that there was some zero mode, right? And what's shown here are the wave functions of that zero mode. And this is that mu over T equals zero. And now, if I, what you will see is that that as I drag this through, this zero mode, so as you see, so this line, the wave function here is the dashed line showing the mu over t parameter here. As I drag it over, this sort of right near the transition, these two zero modes come together, and then they're gone. Well, now these are two fine identities. Okay? So at least numerically, it is clear that from this over this range, these Majorana modes are protected and stable. But they start to disappear when these Majorana modes start to overlap in space. That's when they start to go away. And again, as much as I like Majorana modes, the reason I'm talking about this is that these are generic features of how topological edge modes behave. Okay, so the question is why. So let me end. I have just two minutes left or so. Why are they protected? Actually, you already sort of know the answer. So I told you that Bogoliubov-Degen particle hole told you that if I had a state n with energy e, then I have p n with energy minus e. So they come in pairs, right? So if I have a single Majorana mode and it wants to move away to zero energy, away from zero energy, the question is, where is its pair? It has no pair, right? There's no minus E not equals zero because there was, at least at one end, there was only one mode, one zero energy mode. So that tells you that this zero energy mode just has to stay there until it spreads out enough so that it can see the other mode and then they sort of can split it. They can't move otherwise. Okay? So that's the argument. So now I think the next part I think I'll have to, the bulk edge curse, the bulk topological invariant, I'll discuss in more detail next time. I only have a minute, but let me tell you the bottom line. Let's have a minute and then you can. Summary of bulk invariant. So the strategy is going to be that since I have a zero-dimensional, so I'm going to basically bootstrap from the zero-dimensional invariant and construct one-dimensional invariant. That's going to be my strategy. So I learned that for particle hole symmetry, the invariant was sine of Pfaffian of HBD. This was my topological. But for an infinite, now if I have a one-dimensional system, it's infinite. Okay, I'll just take a minute to finish, or half a minute to finish. So a one-dimensional system is infinite, so how do I calculate the Pfaffian? So if I have translational invariance, then I can write HBDG as a function of K. So there's a conserved momentum, I have translational invariance, I have a conserved momentum, so the parameter K. But K goes to minus K under particle hole symmetry, so not all values of K are particle hole symmetric. I can only have zero or pi. These are my two values of K that are particle hole symmetric, that have particle hole symmetry. So then I take the Pfaffian of those and the sine, and that's my topology. That's going to turn out my topology. And it's going to turn out that whenever this is odd, I have Majorana modes at the end, and when this is even, and we're going to prove that, and that's going to be our bulk edge correspondence. Right? Okay, that's it.